has fallen 5 to 6 meters.
There she is.
I want to crack on and do this before he really runs into trouble. There's some ongoing concern for a potential head and neck injury. Things can go from looking okay to being a quadriplegic or even dead.
Every second counts, every second.
It's life-changing stuff for this guy.
Would you rescue me when I'm by myself? When I need your love, if I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But
very worried for you, my friend.
The bone's being smashed to bits.
Whoa!
He's actually stopped breathing.
Leah.
Without intervention, he's quite likely to die.
Better?
The Royal Melbourne Hospital has one of the busiest emergency departments in the country, with over 250 patients arriving every day by air, ambulance, or on foot.
Happy birthday to
and after 175 years of continuous service, today they're celebrating a milestone. And with an ED that never stops, staff are always on alert to receive patients.
Hello, Royal Melbourne. We're coming to you with a 28-year-old male. He's come off a ladder platform about 6 metres down with impact to his forehead, face, arms, possibly his chest as well.
Emergency doctor Scott Taylor has just started his shift.
Hey, did you delegate this trauma to somebody? Not yet. OK, I'll take it. Yep. We've just taken a call about a young guy who's fallen an estimated 6 metres off a ladder. If he's fallen and hit his head, he may have some injury to his brain. We just don't really know until he's there in front of us. Great, is there trauma coming in here?
The patient is 28-year-old Borcher, a tradie who has lived in Australia for 8 years after moving from Macedonia.
Hi there, mate. What's your name?
Borcher.
I'm Scott, one of the doctors. We're going to be looking after you, OK?
On go. Ready, set, go.
One in five men who fall from a ladder will have a resulting spine or brain injury.
So this is Borcher, 28-year-old male patient.
The team waste no time scanning for internal bleeding and any other life-threatening injuries.
He was working on a scaffolding on the outside of a building and has fallen approximately 5 to 6 metres. He's landed on his forehead with his hands outstretched and landed on his right-hand side.
Borcher's pain could be a sign of a major spine injury.
So we'll organise some pain relief, full spinal, CT pan scan, bloods, and go from there. Just to summarise all that for everyone's benefit, there's some ongoing concern for a potential head and neck injury.
The trauma team finished the initial ultrasound.
His fast scan's negative, which means we don't need to rush him off to the operating theatre. So we're not sure at this stage whether he's actually got an injury to his brain, but I highly suspect that he's going to have some kind of injury to his neck.
I might get X-ray just to come round.
Borcher needs an urgent CT scan to check for neck and spinal injuries. But Dr. Scott must be certain it's safe to move him.
OK, X-ray, thank you. Good, thank you.
See anything? They mentioned maybe some subcut emphysema in his neck.
I couldn't feel any subcut emphysema, but I'm just wondering whether
it's bone. Just bone. Good, mate. We'll get you for some more scans in a minute. With Borcher, I'm expecting that he's going to have some kind of injury to his neck, whether that's a fracture or a dislocation, and that's something that could potentially be catastrophic for him.
What do you do for a job that's got you up 5-6 metres?
I install shutters.
You install shutters?
As Dr. Scott organises the CT scan, the hospital tracked down Borcher's stepbrother, who is now on his way to the ED.
But more so here.
Experienced emergency nurse Susan Hartman knows that keeping Borcher's neck stable could save his life.
Is that comfy?
Can you swallow it? Yeah. Still smile,
still
breathe as normal.
Yeah. Still secure.
Standard procedures after such a fall, we take full spinal precautions, put a collar on him and lay him flat.
With Borcher's neck now stable, he can be moved.
We do need to take him from the trauma bay through the CT scanner, which is risky in itself, because we're taking patients away from what's a stable and controlled environment of the trauma bay to an environment that's very small, that doesn't have the equipment that we need should something go wrong.
Amazing, thank you very much. I'm ready.
If you have a name like Jonathan, right, you know, get used to a life of nicknames. You know, John, Johnny Boy, JJ, John John, J-Man.
Senior emergency doctor Jonathan Papson loves a bit of banter.
So Emma will call me J-Pap sometimes, right, for example. When she calls me Jonathan, whoa, that's big trouble. It's like she's telling me off. Did something wrong. Yeah.
Dr. Jonathan's fun ends with news a trauma patient is on the way.
We're bringing you a 53-year-old male that was involved in a high-speed boating accident.
With over 20 years' experience in ED, Dr. Jonathan has seen the damage caused by every type of crash.
High speed, and he's in a boat.
Yep, yeah, that's correct, and submerged though.
So we've heard there's a high-speed boat crash, and we know that the driver has been submerged underwater for a period of time. What does that actually mean for him? Does it mean he's half drowned? Is he semi-conscious? Are his lungs full of water? So I'm trying to get a picture in my mind of what happened in this crash.
Do boats go at 200 k's an hour?
Yeah, some of them do. Some of the high-speed, like racing boats.
See, we're getting more information now.
He had to be pulled out by divers.
Pulled out by divers. That doesn't sound good.
Father of two, Andrew, was leading a race when he lost control of the powerboat he was driving.
It's racing at
yes.
Melton Weir.
So all right, racing at Melton Weir. Now we're getting the story. Where there would be divers because you get accidents and crashes. Yeah. It's just a motorboat.
Chris.
Right, OK.
Three, one, two, three. Oh!
Breathing.
Down, two, three.
What's he got?
Approximately 11:50. He was in his boat, travelling at 200 kilometres per hour. He's lost control of the vehicle. It's crashed, quickly submerged.
Does that mean it flipped over? Or does it
No, I think just... it just spun out and then sinks.
Hello, sir. What's your name?
His main complaints are left shoulder pain, bilateral elbow pain. That's it.
We'll get some x-rays done.
Hello there.
How you going, mate?
I'm good. My name's Jonathan, one of the specialists. Where are you sore?
Mainly my elbows.
Both elbows hurt, yeah?
Both elbows.
Yeah.
I'm very sore.
And why do you reckon your elbows are sore? Is it from hanging onto some sort of steering wheel or something?
I think the impact when I was hanging onto the steering wheel, maybe.
Yeah.
So a lot of the time when we're dealing with trauma, we're looking at what the mechanism is and how it makes sense with the injury. He's got sore shoulder, sore elbows. I think the term is you're hanging on for dear life.
Andrew, a swimming pool installer, has travelled from Newcastle in New South Wales for the boat race in Victoria.
My wife's at home.
Does she know you're here?
Yeah, he contacted my wife, my son.
Andrew reveals this isn't his first serious water accident.
Well, I've had a broken C6 vertebrae before.
Mm-hmm. Was that from a crash?
No, I was on a boogie board with my 6-year-old niece.
That's one way to go.
Water related, yeah.
It's no surprise to me he's had a broken neck in the past. Would I call Andrew a daredevil, a guy who gets in a boat and drives it at 200 k's an hour? Yeah, I reckon that's a daredevil.
Not being boating experts, yeah, no, I don't really understand the concept, but you're in a capsule. Right.
In a fully enclosed capsule.
Yeah. And then the thing goes...
Five-point harness.
And then you crash.
Oh, shit!
And then it sinks.
I'm concerned about the time Andrew spent underwater. Our job is to look for what's going to kill him right now, and that is lung injury, broken ribs, or a neck injury.
Oh, shit!
We're going to put you in the scanner anyway, the CT scanner.
I'm happy to do whatever you say.
53-year-old Andrew is being treated after the motorboat he was racing crashed at incredibly high speed.
Everything was under control. Something just went wrong.
Oh! Oh, shit!
So I'm concerned about the time Andrew spent underwater. Did he just hold his breath and then jump out, or was he fully submerged, totally underwater for ages?
So, Jane,
yeah.
The lungs look fine on ultrasound. There's no pneumothorax, there's no hemothorax, and his oxygen saturation's good.
It doesn't look like we're dealing with what we would call a near-drowning incident. This is more of a trauma-to-the-chest situation.
I've got an air mask on in the boat.
Yep. So it wasn't like you were underwater with water flooding your lungs or anything?
No, definitely not.
And the divers get you out, but you're not actually underwater when they got you out?
No, I was more on top of the water.
You were on top of the water, yeah.
So Andrew tells me he's actually got an oxygen mask and an oxygen supply as part of his kit when he's driving the boat. That makes a lot of sense. And now I understand why his lungs are okay.
We're just going to check and make sure your back's not broken.
Yeah.
You just keep your head nice and still. Sorry, Andrew, not to feel comfortable. All right, on my count, 1, 2, 3.
Very good. All right, is it sore right in the middle where I'm pressing?
No, yes. No, it's nothing there at all.
Not here?
No.
Here?
No.
Here?
No.
We log roll Andrew, feeling down the middle of his spine to feel for a fracture in his thoracic and lumbar spine. It actually feels all right.
Thigh bone pain?
Yeah.
Concerned about Andrew's obvious pain, it's a careful process of elimination for Dr. Jonathan.
So the next step is now to go to the CT scanner and look for any other injuries, like the back of his shoulder, the shoulder blade. We're still worried about his neck, but I've got him in the collar, so it's not going to get any worse.
I wonder...
Elbow.
I wonder if he's ruptured the biceps tendon.
Bicep muscle.
Yeah.
Has been detached off the bone.
Previously.
Right, yeah.
4 years ago. Yeah.
And that's his problem. He's got sore elbows. It's a jarring sort of thing.
Is it sore at the front?
No, it's like you can press it.
The trouble is that's distracting him from other stuff as well. So, yeah, your elbows are sore, but have you got other injuries? Maybe. So we are going to treat this very seriously.
Any high-speed crash, people can break their neck. So he may have a spinal injury, definitely. And by that, I mean they could become a paraplegic or a quadriplegic. This is the worst-case scenario.
Hi, 28-year-old tradie Borcher has been sent for a CT scan after he fell 6 metres off a ladder onto his head.
On 1, 2, 3. Here we go.
He was complaining of neck pain right higher up, and the higher the injury that you get, there's more severe complications that can occur.
The scan will reveal if the simple act of climbing a ladder has changed Borcher's life forever.
Please breathe in and hold your breath.
Nurse Susan anxiously waits for the results to come through.
Fractured right through there. So that's C2, that whole block is C2, that's C1, and it's fractured right in the heart. That's quite a high spinal fracture, so you'd be very concerned for neurogenic shock, so it's quite serious.
The results are the last thing that Dr. Scott wants to see.
Oh, man. Oh, so he's fractured through his C2 vertebrae and it's shifted backwards into his spinal canal. Oh, man. This part here should be sitting on top of that, all as one bone, but he's smashed that right off. Oh. What we're seeing is a fracture at the bottom of the C2, and that fracture's tipping backwards, which reduces the amount of space in that spinal canal and can cause some pretty significant problems as far as people's ability to move their arms and legs.
but also their ability to breathe. It's certainly a worst case scenario here.
Everybody ready? One, two.
The slightest head movement could sever Borchia's spine.
And what level is your pain now?
Checking for other injuries now takes on a new urgency. Nurse Susan closely monitors Borchia to make sure he keeps breathing.
Still okay?
Yeah. I can't breathe at all.
You can't breathe. It's hard. You mean it's hard to breathe? Just slow deep breath.
As the radiographers begin x-raying, Nurse Susan grows increasingly concerned.
You can't feel getting the air in, or?
Yeah, like, see, it's like half the lot.
Just try and do it slowly, all right? You tell me if you don't, can't get your air in, okay? So he's finding it difficult to breathe. We've got to get back to trauma as soon as we can. Every second counts, every second.
And then I'll put a bit of oxygen on it.
Borchia's condition is life-threatening.
Having difficulties breathing.
Yeah, he's got a displaced dens.
And then I'll put a bit of oxygen on it.
Having difficulties breathing, even though his sensor is up.
Yeah, he's got a displaced dens.
Dr. Scott is rushing to 28-year-old tradie Borchia, who's broken his neck in a ladder fall and is now having major difficulty breathing.
You guys okay here?
Well, I'm just a bit
cuddled.
Yeah.
Borch, you've got a pretty significant injury to your neck.
Yeah.
You've broken your neck.
Yeah.
And it's probably putting pressure on your spinal cord.
Yeah.
All right. That's right at the level that controls your breathing. I'm very worried for you, my friend. I'm really sorry. I'm really worried.
Yeah.
It's certainly possible that he might become a quadriplegic with this kind of injury. Breaking bad news is always tricky. I'd like to say that it gets easier with experience, but changing somebody's life with news of that magnitude is not an enjoyable part of the job. It still breaks your heart every time. I need to talk to a few people urgently.
Yes.
We might need to do something to put you to sleep for a little bit and support your breathing with a breathing machine.
Yeah.
Okay?
Okay.
This is an emergency. We need to urgently take control of his breathing by putting a breathing tube into his throat and putting him on a ventilator that'll breathe for him. Things can go from looking okay and just having a fracture to being a quadriplegic or even dead very, very quickly.
Oh.
I might give anaesthetics and ICU a call now, I think. I was wondering if we might be able to list your services. We have a 28-year-old down in Trauma 1 who's now feeling short of breath. We think he needs an early tube.
You can go and say hi.
Borchia is still reeling from the shocking news when his stepbrother Darko arrives.
He looks worried, and that's what worries me. He just tells me that he has a broken back. I don't know whether he's going to be able to use his limbs like he could previously. I don't know that he's going to live at this stage. I just know that it's going to be very serious.
How's your breathing?
It's okay, but it's...
Bit better with the oxygen?
Yeah. If you can, put more oxygen.
More oxygen?
Yeah.
Okay.
He's on 2 liters.
Yeah, okay. But you feel like you're having to breathe with your tummy and your chest?
In my mouth.
The team must take over Borchia's breathing to save his life.
It's important that we get this breathing tube in as soon as possible before things get worse. For this, I want our anaesthetics team in the room and ideally doing the procedure. We want our most skilled and experienced hands on deck. We're just kind of preempting things, knowing that we're going to need an MRI. I don't want him to deteriorate while he's in the MRI machine when we can't do anything about it. I want to crack on and do this before he really runs into trouble.
Yeah.
Coral, Melbourne. We're coming in about 10, 15 minutes with a 35-year-old female. Cyclist burst car. We've had a head strike with loss of consciousness and some retrograde amnesia with a GPS.
Emergency nurse and resus team leader Gunnar Pedersen has just learned an ambulance is rushing to emergency carrying a woman who has been knocked off her bicycle.
The first thing I hear, cyclist, car, no helmet. The first injuries that I think about are head injuries, because they are the most dangerous things that you can bleed to death from. Humans are not made to have an impact with metal objects.
ETA about 10 minutes, guys.
As Gunnar readies the trauma bay for all possible scenarios.
All right, so cyclist versus car.
The ambulance arrives carrying 35-year-old Mylen. Originally from Argentina, Mylen now works as a filmmaker in Melbourne.
No seizures on route.
No seizures on route.
Yeah, just on scene.
Immediately after the accident, she has a seizure. That is a major worry. That means that there's been a significant impact to the brain, something that's affecting the structure of the brain and the electrical function of the brain.
Ready, set, go.
Leading the trauma team is senior emergency doctor Jana Alexander.
So this is Malene. She's a 35-year-old female cyclist first car. She was a cyclist, travelling approximately 15 k's an hour, was not wearing a helmet. She has had a head strike, as well as a seizure lasting approximately a minute. She appears to have a head laceration coming from her head, unsure where, due to the amount of bleeding. She also appears to have a dislocated left thumb.
This is not what I need.
That's okay, you look after you, you're safe, right?
With Mylen bleeding heavily from the head, Dr. Jana is worried about other, possibly hidden injuries.
My main concern with Mylen is that she wasn't wearing a helmet. She's got a lot of bleeding from this big wound on her head, but also what it can suggest is bleeding on the brain. Depending on how severe the bleed is, it's potentially life-threatening. In her case, it could be significantly debilitating.
Just gonna check your pupils. Can you open your eyes for us?
The accident happened as a car attempted to overtake Mylen on the e-bike she had rented to travel to work.
Are you sore anywhere at the moment?
Mylen's severe head injury means the trauma team can quickly deploy extra resources if needed.
She's been upgraded to a trauma call for blood pressure of 85.
So the moment that I hear that Mylen has been upgraded to a trauma call, that means that everything has escalated. I need more staff. I need more equipment.
She might have a big laceration.
Mylen has been bleeding so much from her head that her matted hair makes it difficult to see the wound.
We're just trying to identify the source of bleeding at the moment.
Yeah.
It's
essential that we keep her immobilized, so we call that spinal immobilization, where we put a collar on the neck. If she's got a neck injury, any movement could potentially cause a spinal cord injury, which would be devastating for her.
Try not to move your neck, okay? It's really important. Just in case there is a fracture, you could be paralyzed if you move it.
Do you have any problems with your kidney or thyroid?
No.
53-year-old powerboat racer Andrew is having a CT scan after a high-impact accident may have left him with a life-changing injury.
The CT is there to rule out all the nasty injuries that I'm worried about, like broken ribs, broken neck, broken back. That's what the CT is going to show me.
Can you open support that right hand?
Yeah.
Andrew's friend and fellow racer Warwick has rushed in from where the crash happened, over 50 kilometres away.
I saw what happened, the barrel roll, but I can't explain why it happened. I thought the worst, as you instantly do. It's pretty bad.
I've been looking for you.
Oh, okay. Well, it's a wake up call, Lee.
What?
Yeah, I'm done.
Hey?
You're done?
I'm done.
You're not going to do it again?
I'm not doing it with you if you do.
Andrew's wife, Marissa.
Yeah, give her a buzz.
Has been waiting anxiously at home to find out how severe his injuries are.
Hello?
How you going, boss? I'm just lying here, just waiting on all the results, so I thought I'd give you a call.
You talked to
Rob, did you? No, I'm thinking about that myself, but anyway, discuss it when I get home. I love you. Speak to you soon.
With the CT scan results in, Dr. Jonathan is surprised by what he sees.
This is the way your shoulder blade is supposed to look. It's not supposed to do this. It's not supposed to be in pieces. That's bad. Yeah, that's going to really hurt.
Andrew has broken his shoulder blade, fractured his scapula, and whenever that breaks, that means a lot of force has actually gone through his shoulder blade.
Dr. Jonathan now has to break the terrible news to Andrew that his racing days could be over.
Your shoulder blade's sort of shattered in a few bits, so you're going to be fine, but you're going to be a bit sore. Are you sore?
Yeah.
This is going to end your career in speedboat racing. What are you going to do? You're going to keep doing it? Or is...
It's a sport that you're either in or you're out.
Right.
I've been in it my whole life. My dad was in it.
All right, I'll check in with you later on.
Thank you.
Andrew seems undecided if he'll ever take part again in the sport he so passionately loves.
Don't know. See what happens. It's a lot of money invested. In financial-wise, probably not. Heart-wise, probably yes.
Amazingly, with that kind of injury, you don't need an operation. So we'll usually put people in a sling so it doesn't move, and then the body will heal it in place.
Morning, how are you?
Nurse Unit Manager Susan Harding oversees a group of colleagues like Paul Casey, known as nurse practitioners.
So a nurse practitioner is essentially a registered nurse who has done a higher level of education at a master's degree level, where they have the experience, expertise to diagnose and treat a number of patients.
Paul's journey to become a nurse practitioner started 10 years ago.
I always thought I was going to do something. My brother, Ben, is a nurse. And I said, tell me if it's good enough for you, it's good enough for me.
His skills are put into practice with Nicholas, who's been rushed into ED by his girlfriend, Sophie, with a dislocated shoulder.
What happened?
We were just lying in bed. I have a slack shoulder already.
Right, okay.
And I had my arm like this, and Anso was there.
Yeah.
And we just moved, and it quite surprisingly came out the back.
His shoulder, it's obviously not in the right place. The longer that it stays out, the muscles kind of tense up and create more pain.
This isn't the first time Nicholas has dislocated his shoulder.
It happened probably like 6-7 times. Yeah.
But this is the first time Nurse Paul has ever attempted to put a dislocated shoulder back into place.
I've been involved in many, but I've not been the man that actually pops it back in.
All right, you have a chug on that for me.
Emergency doctor Jane Hamilton is there to help if needed.
Just keep there.
Keep having a go at that.
Nurse Paul gives Nicholas nitrous oxide to help with the pain.
Just relax. Let me move your arm, OK?
The idea is to go up and then sort of rotate. So we're going in this kind of motion, rotating out, and then hopefully the joint just comes back in.
Just keep breathing it, keep breathing it.
Back in. Nice there, isn't it?
No, no, keep breathing that stuff.
It's very frustrating for me because obviously I don't like seeing people in pain.
Years and years of muscle memory of being tense on the shoulder, and I think it's probably making the job a bit harder.
He might just need sedation to relax the muscles.
I think it is pretty tense there, so I think...
I'm thinking at the moment that we may perhaps need to sedate Nicholas. There's a lot of complications that may arise in doing so, so it's our last resort in a scenario.
Can I say something?
Yeah.
Yep.
It happened once before, and they tied a sheet around me and held me from that side.
Okay.
And then pulled me that way.
Right.
If he's had success with that before, then we can give it a try. So he's kind of the expert in this way rather than us.
You just sort of thread that in underneath.
Under there, yeah.
We put a sheet under his shoulder and someone's applying some traction from the other end.
I'm going to go down and up and out on it.
Sorry.
The sheep method doesn't work.
Not really budging, is it? Sedation, yeah.
I want to crack on and do this before he really runs into trouble.
Yeah.
28-year-old tradie Borchair is fighting to breathe after breaking his neck and damaging his spinal cord in a fall.
Can you hear me? Still. He's got a short of breath.
Borchair needs an urgent MRI scan, but he can't be moved until he's intubated.
I'm going to get anaesthetics to tube.
A process that will help him breathe when they induce a coma.
If we weren't to intubate him at this point, we'd be taking him to an MRI scanner where he's away in a very small, confined area where we can't get to him in a hurry. And if that bleeding around his fracture were to get worse, his heart rate might drop very low or stop.
Here now. Yep. Hey, guys, thanks for coming down.
The anaesthetics team arrive and the intubation procedure can now begin.
Oh, mate, it's going to be a sharp sting in your wrist here.
You're okay? You're doing okay?
No. So, intubation, Scott's going to do drugs, Mark's going to be primary airway.
Intubating someone's a very risky procedure and can be technically quite difficult in somebody who's got an unstable injury to their neck. We need to give him some medication to put him to sleep and keep him still before we do the procedure.
Beautiful.
Good.
We are happy with
you. Is everybody happy to start?
Okay.
Yep.
Any distraction in the high-risk procedure could be fatal. Our main cameras leave.
So I'm going to give 150 milligrams of ketamine, followed immediately by 150 milligrams of rocuronium.
How you going there? You all right?
Good. You watching that clock?
I am.
Beautiful.
There's about 45 seconds to a minute after we give the medication where he stops breathing. And then once we take away that ability for him to breathe on his own, we need to get the tube in as quick as possible. Because he's not breathing on his own, he's not able to get enough oxygen in. That can be really dangerous if his oxygen levels drop at that point.
That's good, 45 seconds.
Sats are 100. You've got end tidal.
If something goes wrong and we can't get the tube in through the mouth, then we need somebody who's going to be able to step up and cut the neck and put a tube in through the front of the neck. And in this situation, it would have to be me.
Take out the stylet for me, please.
Stylet
out. Great job.
With the tube now in, Borchair's breathing is taken over by a ventilator.
Beautiful.
Thank you, guys. Great job, everybody. Really, really good job.
Get that sedation up and running?
Yep, already going. This man's gone from, one day being perfectly healthy and fully functioning, and the next day we don't know what's going to come of this.
From here, he's going to go to the MRI scanner. Once that's done, he'll go up to the intensive care unit. At this stage, it's too early to know whether he's going to make a full recovery or not.
I suspect he's probably going to need an operation. And, he could be quadriplegic and in a wheelchair forever. He could, in fact, die from these injuries. This life-changing stuff for this guy.
Try not to move your neck, OK? It's really important. Just in case there is a fracture, you could be paralyzed.
Bike rider Mylen has a severe head injury and a possible neck fracture after being hit by a car.
Can I get you to take Rhesus 5 to CT urgently?
A major trauma has just arrived in the ED. Nurse Gunner is called away to help.
Oh, good, mate. Give me a shout if you need me.
And Dr. Jana's vast experience is also urgently needed. Emergency doctor Zahir Jehoon takes over Mylen's care.
What we're concerned about is the fact that you've had this seizure when I don't think you normally have seizures, do you?
A seizure is essentially a disruption of the nerve signals in the head, and what that means is that she's suffered a big knock as she's hit the ground.
Sometimes what can happen is after a head injury, there can be sort of injury to the brain.
It could also mean that there's a potential for there being bleeding in the brain, bruising in the brain, or with the blood loss that she's got, potentially even a skull fracture.
We'll do a CT scan of not just your head, but also your neck, chest and abdomen as well.
Like anyone who suffered a major accident, Mylen wants her loved ones around her.
I can sense that she's quite afraid In our time of need, we so desperately want to be around those that are close to us.
Do you have a partner or a friend that you want us to talk to?
They managed to track down her ex-boyfriend, Max.
I had an accident. I rented one of those bikes. Someone calls me with the cops. I called him because I would like for you to be here. I don't know who else to call.
The magnitude of her accident is a lot for Mylene to take in.
Has anyone seen your thumb?
No.
Have you had x-rays?
No.
Right, I'm going to get some x-rays for that.
As well as the troubling head wound, Mylene has a severely dislocated left thumb.
So, you can put your arm out by some stroke. Do your left hand and your right elbow.
Dr. Zahir can now see the extensive damage to Mylene's hand.
What we can see over here is that the finger, which should be nice and straight, is very obviously bent. So she's got a dislocation of her thumb.
Understanding Mylene needs his support, her ex-boyfriend Max arrives along with her friend Galen.
I'm in pain yesterday, but the seizure, that's stressed me out a little.
The unfortunate decision not to wear a bike helmet could have life-changing consequences.
So in terms of the CT scan, we're worried about possible serious brain injuries. Because she's taken a big knock to the head, we're also worried about a neck, and we're worried about potential spinal cord injury.
All right, we're gonna take off now, guys. Thank you,
absolutely.
35-year-old Mylene is about to be scanned after a bicycle accident with a car left her with a severe head injury and possible neck and spinal fractures.
Nice and still. This first part of the scan takes about 2 minutes.
The CT scan is of utmost importance. We're worried about a skull fracture, that we see a large bleed, and that we see a major fracture in the neck.
While they wait for scan results, Dr. Zahir prepares to put Malin's dislocated thumb back into place.
Deep breath in and out.
Thankfully, Max is by her side.
Before we relocate her thumb, we have to give her some local anesthetic, and that's essentially some medication that will numb her arm completely. Wonderful, doing really well. Focus on your right hand.
So well. In through the nose, out through the mouth.
There we go.
Yes.
Nice and straight. Look at that.
Woohoo!
Brand new.
The CT results will tell Dr. Zahir if Mylene has life-changing brain or neck injuries.
There's no obvious bleed. What we can see is a lot of bruising and that bleeding, that cut, which has caused all that blood on her face. So in the CT brain scan result, what we see is that she's got a laceration to the side of the head. Reassuringly, it seems that the inside of the brain, there isn't any major bleed. And then when we look at the neck, she's got a fracture up the top of the neck, which can be concerning in itself because it can cause injury to the spinal cord. Her staying still is absolutely critical at this point because any unnecessary movement or could potentially mean that there's pressure that's put on the spinal cord, which could lead to its absolute worst, paralysis. Along the neck, about towards the bottom of the neck, you've got a very small fracture in the spine. From what I can see, there's no injury to the actual spinal cord. Just for the moment, we'll keep that on. I will just do everything you can to keep nice and still. And then I'll speak to the orthopedic surgeons to get their thoughts on what they think we should do about what we need to worry about with the neck.
For now, Mylene will stay in emergency until the orthopedic surgeons decide on next steps.
Mylene has today made the decision to get on a rental bike because she needs to get from point A to point B quite quickly for work purposes. And unfortunately, the rental bike that she's gotten on did not come with a helmet. So she's made the unfortunate decision to take that trip without wearing one.
Sometimes it's good to go through these too. Remember how fragile we are?
To
Anything else I can do for the moment?
No, that's okay. No,
that's okay. We'll catch up again soon, all right? Pleasure.
Really punching, isn't it?
Nurse practitioner Paul is grappling with the dislocated shoulder of 30-year-old architect Nicholas.
Let's try again. No. Sedation, yeah.
Me and Jane, one of the registrars, have tried to get the shoulder back in. We are all, like, trying to think of other methods of getting the shoulder in that don't involve sedation.
Realising he needs help with Nicholas's shoulder...
What's Chung-Yi's number?
Nurse Paul tries calling emergency doctor Sung Chung at the very same time as Dr. Chung pops in to see how he's going.
Oh, Chung-Yi, we probably need to give him a bit of sedation. We've tried it with nitrous.
Chung is like the invisible man who suddenly appears. He's a go-to person for me because I value his knowledge and experience.
Dr. Chung immediately offers a solution.
Do you want to set him on his belly?
On his belly?
Come over the side.
Okay.
I'm very happy that he sees me as this invisible man coming in.
Hello, Chung. Nice to meet you, one of the other doctors.
Hi.
Have you ever done it this way?
Not that I remember.
Okay. This technique, lying prone, is my go-to technique, and I'm very comfortable, I'm very familiar with it. If this technique doesn't work, I'm going to have to sedate Nicholas.
Sure.
I'm going to gently pull down on your arm, mm-hmm. and Paul here is going to push on your scapula here, this way, okay? So just the wing, angle it that way.
Yeah.
We'll go gently. Push for?
I am.
A bit sore, are you, Nick? Just try your best to relax. I'm going to gently pull down on your arm, mm-hmm. and Paul here is going to push on your scapula here, this way, okay?
The team is trying to fix the dislocated shoulder of 30-year-old Nicholas.
So just the wing, angle it that way.
Yeah.
We'll go gently.
As Dr. Chung pulls Nicholas's arm and Nurse Paul pushes the shoulder blade, they're hoping the ball of the arm will pop back into the socket.
Push harder?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's good,
yeah. You tell me what you want me to
do.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, there we go. Felt that.
OK, done.
Yeah, I felt that move then.
Fortunately, it worked, and it was very satisfying because I could feel it go back in, and I'm sure it's very satisfying for Nick as well because he felt instantly better.
How you going?
Yeah, good. Sorry for the ordeal.
No,
it's all right.
It's just a different technique of putting the shoulder back in. I think the patient did most of the work. It's just a matter of relaxing the muscles.
It feels good to have it back in, so thanks to the team.
I got a good outcome for the patient, and I learned something new that I hadn't known previously. So I was quite happy from that point of view.
53-year-old Andrew arrived at the Royal Melbourne after crashing the powerboat he was racing at 200 kilometres an hour.
Something just went wrong.
Oh, shit!
A CT scan revealed he had broken his scapula.
Your shoulder blade's sort of shattered in a few bits. This is going to end your career in speedboat racing.
A couple of days later, Andrew's in a sling and recovering with wife Marissa by his side.
The wife's not real impressed with me having another go at it, so...
It's not racing again. That's it.
There's a fair bit of footage of it.
I haven't watched it at all.
That's a bit scary when you sit back and look at it. How close I really was to probably not being here.
30-year-old architect Nicholas was brought into ED with a dislocated shoulder.
Back in.
Nurse practitioner Paul struggled to get it back into place.
Almost there, isn't it?
Not there.
And called on Dr. Chung for help.
Do you want to set him on his belly?
On his belly?
Working together, they were able to relocate the shoulder.
Oh, yeah, there we go. Felt that.
Okay, done.
Yeah, I felt that move then.
And Nicholas and Sophie were able to go home. 35-year-old cyclist Malin was hit by a car and suffered a severe head wound as she wasn't wearing a helmet.
Are you sore anywhere at the moment? No. In the head.
The team feared bleeding on the brain and a neck injury. A CT scan revealed bad news.
Along the neck, about towards the bottom of the neck, you've got a very small fracture in the spine. And I'll speak to the orthopaedic surgeons to get their thoughts on what they think we should do about what we need to worry about with the neck.
Malin spent the next 3 days in hospital, where orthopaedic surgeons concluded the fracture would heal by itself. Malin flew back to Argentina to be with her family for 6 weeks and is now back in Australia. 28-year-old tradie Borchair was rushed into the ED after falling 6 metres off a ladder. Dr. Scott feared the pain in his neck was a sign of a major spinal injury.
Oh, man. He's fractured through his C2 vertebrae and it's shifted backwards into his spinal canal. Borsch, you've broken your neck.
Yeah.
I'm very worried for you, my friend. I'm really sorry. I'm really worried.
Yeah.
5 months later, Borchair is at home recovering, with his stepbrother Darko keeping a close eye on him.
Good to be out.
Yes, thank you to the doctors.
The doctors put Borchair into a halo head brace to keep his head from being able to rotate and to keep his spine aligned, as he'd fractured 2 or 3 of his vertebrae, and he had to be kept incredibly still for them to recover correctly.
Borchair has showed incredible determination to get his life back on track.
From when Borchair had his accident, he could completely do everything himself after 1 month.
How do you feel?
I am good.
Yeah?
I'm better now.
Not good.
I think that this accident has made Borchair more aware how quickly things can change in life, and to seize the moment, but also maybe to be a little bit more careful next time.